Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Arbiter by Alexey Osadchuk, translated by Andrew Douglas Schmidt, narrated by Derek Shoales. Chapter 1. I was summoned to the Queen's office in the middle of the night. Based on the grim look on her personal secretary's face, I would not be finding Gaia Longbraid in high spirits. Once in the office, I was taken out onto the terrace where I saw the Queen of the Gnomes deep in thought. She was standing at the balustrade with her hands perched on the wide stone railing. Her eyes were fixed on the sleeping city below. She didn't react to my entrance in any way, but after her secretary had left, the ruler of all gnomes started softly.
"We're alone now.
I assume the Emperor's messengers reached you?" Gally gave a nasty smirk.
"I still cannot understand why they call him an emperor. After all, he's nothing but a puppet in the hands of Shitang and his magister buddies."
I just shrugged and said nothing. What was there to say? She was right. Even the most ignorant peasant from the most distant backwater knows that the true ruler of the Empire is the Order of Mages. "What is his official position?" I inquired.
"Now that was funny," the Queen snorted. "He says there is no war between the Empire and the Gnomes. He called our conflict with Fradia a personal matter."
"In other words, he doesn't support the Steel King either?"
"Not officially, no," Gallius shook her head.
"And unofficially?"
"Unofficially, anyone who wishes to join the minor local conflict with the Gnomes is free to take part as a mercenary."
"Uh-huh," I said, rubbing my chin. "Just a different angle on the same picture. Have all the players come forward?"
"Almost," the Queen nodded. "The Northerners are sending 5,000 troops, 100 mages, and 40 ice giants."
I frowned. Darda. To be frank, I wasn't expecting them to stand by the Steel King. After all, they were the most devastated region in the Age of the Dead Wars.
"All the history books have been rewritten. The truth has been forgotten. The real story is buried beneath a thick layer of lies and fabrications."
I rubbed the back of my head.
"What about the Southerners?"
"The princes of Etria are sending 3,000 riders. They will also be joined by around 5,000 lizard folk."
"Iveria?"
2,000 swordsmen. The Western Isles won't be sitting the conflict out either."
"So the Dead Ocean is under enemy control," I observed. Gallia chuckled.
"I'm sure those pirates jumped at the chance to join. They'd do nothing but pillage if they could. They, by the way, will be the ones transporting the enemy troops to our lands."
"Any news from Teria?" I asked, trying to keep my voice steady.
"Your king has not yet said a thing,"
the Queen responded and hit me with a pensive gaze. She must have noticed my anxiety slipping through.
"We did warn Stefane II about the fledgling conspiracy, but he didn't react. Honestly, though, it was implied that they had their own problems to sort out."
I breathed a heavy sigh. That didn't seem likely. The ruler of my native Teria is known as the Soft for a reason. If the Order of Mages is on the case, we will very soon be hearing about his deposal.
"As a matter of fact," Gallia said, tilting her head to the side, "I see no reason to help your king either. Even if we can prevent Stefane II's overthrow, he still won't support us. And that's despite his indignation after the shameful breaking of his son's engagement."
"What makes you so sure?" I was sincerely surprised.
"We are gnomes," the Queen shrugged her shoulders significantly. "Non-humans. Stefane II won't go against his fellow humans for our sake."
I was already preparing counter-arguments, but Galliard's words cooled my ardor. She was 1,000 times correct. The Tarians would never go to war against the Dartans on the side of non-humans, especially gnomes who, to put it lightly, are not particularly beloved in either Teria or Darda.
"By the way, now that it's come up,"
Gallia started and stared intently into my eyes,
"you may have to do battle against your own countrymen."
She just trailed off and stood there, sizing me up with her gaze.
"You know," I said thoughtfully, "you are not the first to ask me this question. Here is my response. It is not a simple situation, but I've already made my choice. If my countrymen choose the side of darkness, I will always fight against them with no remorse or hesitation. But whether their choice will be conscious or not is a different question."
"Agreed,"
the Queen nodded, and the look in her eyes warmed.
"They may not exactly be aware who they are fighting for, and that little nuance gives us room to maneuver." For some time, we both sat in quiet contemplation. Gallia was the first to break the silence.
All told, we will be up against around 25,000 soldiers just in mercenaries, she said mutedly. Out of that fraud, you steal legions and the Order of Mages. And that will not be all. Your intel is partially checked out. Hordes of necromorphs have flooded onto the steppe. Do you believe the Steel King was working in concert with the Order of Mages from the start?
No way. I quickly refuted that possibility. I once had the chance to witness a conversation between the King and his captain. Beyond that, I journeyed in the wastes for some time with two Fradian spies. They were tracking Order messengers and Orcish shamans. The Horde incursion was Magister Shitang's handiwork. It must have been a way for him to try and put pressure on Egbert.
Well, that clears things up.
Gallia waved a hand and cringed in disgust.
In the end, the two rats struck up a friendship and formed an alliance, reinforcing it by getting their kids hitched. And the Orcish shamans were left empty-handed. In fact, their warriors were used as food.
What do you mean? I asked.
Just what I said, the queen responded. The necromancers, nourished by the dark energy from the portal, had begun using the bodies of dead steppe dwellers to create their abominations.
I felt a tingle run down my spine. I remember that there were thousands of slaves there other than the orcs. By now, they had all probably been doomed to an afterlife as soulless monsters, subjugated to the will of vile warlocks. I clenched my teeth and fists. Gallia must have sensed my mood. Her hand set down on my shoulder.
I know what you are thinking, she said softly. And most likely I will not be able to stop you. I want to tell you merely that you are not alone any longer. Before you go rushing into battle, think everything through carefully and prepare yourself.
Just a few months earlier, that would have been just what I needed to hear. But now she was talking to a different man. Thanks to my will, I was in excellent control of my emotions. Even though my heart was overflowing with rage, I wasn't going to rush headlong into a fight. And that was exactly why I had yet to go to the Stone Forest. I needed to prepare before setting off to close the cursed portal. Most likely to distract me from the dismal thoughts, Gallia asked.
How do things stand on the Dark Continent?
I believe the necromancers have reached there as well. There must be another dark portal somewhere in the mountains. How else could they get all the energy necessary to create those flying brutes?
Agreed, she nodded. Are you prepared to repulse the attack?
The heart of the forest grows not by the day but by the hour, I responded, and Foreston grows along with it. If the necromancers think they can attack us so easily, they have lots of surprises in store.
Not if, but when, Gallia corrected me. They're sure to attack. It's just a matter of time.
After saying that, the queen fell silent. A shadow fell on her face. What's the matter? I asked.
Ugh, she sighed heavily. I wish we had just a bit longer. I sense we're in for a rough time. And that means, if not for you, I'd have been up against all these armies by myself. We had hope for the elves. After all, you did bring a heart to the forest, but they have chosen to sit this one out like they always do.
Not all of them, I corrected her. She just waved it off.
A few thousand outcasts, refugees, most of them women and children. They don't count.
But it is something.
Yes, I understand, she answered gloomily, but not enough. Our clans can field around 14,000 troops. You'll be bringing 1,000 at most. You do understand, after all, that in that case, we'll have to bear the brunt of the onslaught. We have nowhere to turn for help. 15,000 troops and 200 mages are all we have.
Not exactly, I shook my head.
If you're referring to our personal abilities, then
no, not that either. Gallia frowned.
Then explain.
Why haven't you mentioned the Bronze Legion? I asked. Gallia's face unwrinkled, and a smile came on her lips.
I see you wasted no time in Stenborg, she said with notes of derision. You filled your head with ancient gnomish fairy tales.
I responded with a smile. Perhaps I have, but are they just fairy tales? The gnome spent some time staring searchingly into my eyes. And then, clearly having made up her mind, she said with a deep sigh,
No, they are not just fairy tales.
Then she fell silent. Could you tell me more? I asked, adding a bit of pressure.
Do you really want to know about that heap of useless scrap?
She asked in frustration.
Yes, I replied firmly.
Why do you want to know?
It's just that I've seen what the golems your craftsman made can do. So why then is the Bronze Legion useless?
It's a long story.
I don't have anywhere to be, I shrugged. I won't be getting any sleep tonight anyway. Since you've summoned me, tell me the story.
There's nothing to tell, she waved it off. To sum it up, over the centuries the golem's inner workings have been eviscerated. All the crystals have disappeared. Only the shells and mechanisms remain.
I snorted. And how many are there?
3,000 lancers, 2,000 sword fighters, and 1,000 archers.
Whoa, I exclaimed.
6,000 golems? I'm scared to even imagine the kinds of things an army like that could do. Like I said, Gallia muttered out crossly, that pile of scrap metal can't do a thing anymore. It's all thanks to my short-sighted relatives who sold off all the crystals like the two-bit hucksters they were.
What kind of crystals do you need? I asked.
Three kinds. Mana, life, and energy. And to get ahead of your question, yes, it will take a lot of crystals.
I spent some time in thought, which earned me a suspicious look from the gnome. Then, here's my question. I finally made up my mind. Let's suppose we could find enough crystals to bring all your golems to life. What would be our next move? Gallia squinted and looked at me.
What are you scheming about now?
First, answer my question.
All right, she relented. Our next move would be to fill the golem's hearts with power.
I assume we'd need Gramner's help for that?
Indeed,
the gnome nodded slowly.
The city's supply will not do. We need power on a whole other order of magnitude.
Let me guess, I smiled. The Forge of the True Flame?
Yes,
she responded and repeated her question.
So, what are you scheming about, Eric?
I smiled. Well, by complete coincidence, I just so happen to have information on the location of the body of a guardian of the Lord of the Deep. Gallia latched into my shoulder with her right hand and whispered hopefully.
You're not joking, are you?
Does it sound like it? I winced. It felt like my shoulder was in a vice grip.
Sorry, Rick,
she said, quickly pulling her hand back.
But how? Actually, just a second. The matriarch?
Exactly, I nodded and smiled.
So, you know where to find the body of the stone snake?
Gallia whispered, looking thoughtfully at a fixed point. After that, sharply raising her head, she shot out.
When do we leave?
I shook my head. We are not ready for the quest. And you are not coming with us.
But why not?
She asked in surprise, but quickly guessed.
The matriarch does not wish to share her secret with me.
I nodded. You are right. I mentally rubbed my hands together. It isn't only the matriarch. Sure, we're allies, but I don't want her coming with either. I'm not planning to give away all my loot to the gnomes. Plus, this way, Gallia will have to repay me for all the crystals I bring in.
Is there anything I can do to help?
She asked. I'll need lots of S's and tablets. I'm willing to buy them at any price. I'm particularly interested in skill and spell tablets, and lots of S's.
I see,
the queen said thoughtfully. The mention of money seemed to sober her. I meanwhile let her know I was not begging for help empty-handed. I was willing to pay.
Good, she said firmly. You'll have your tablets, and you'll have your S's. I think I can get together everything you need within 1 week.
I smiled. And in 1 week, I will go to the border of the abyss. Chapter 2. The following week was packed full of hustle and bustle. Every day, I warped from Foreston to Stenborg and back 2 or 3 times. Me was back in our hotel suite in the gnomish capital. With the fox maidens as bodyguards, he was receiving and sorting the tablets, S's, and crystals being delivered by Maddie and his cousin's couriers. His cousin in particular seemed to have realized I was something of a gold mine, so he was really going all out. The gnomes brought us the first shipment of tablets as a gift, but each time thereafter I paid in gold. Thankfully, that was never in short supply. Me, by the way, got his bearings very quickly, especially after we leveled his trade skill. Over the past week, he'd essentially sprouted himself a network of informants keeping him abreast of changes on the market. And so, when couriers came to pay him a visit, the savvy gremlin quibbled over the price of every tablet until his voice was hoarse, earning him respect from the bearded peddlers. He also took the fox maidens by surprise. At first, they treated him with a certain aversion. Despite all the times I called the gremlin my friend and brother, the fox maidens looked on me as a little inconspicuous servant who I, for some reason, had made my familiar. But by day two, they realized they were wrong when the usually timid and quiet gremlin harshly put some disrespectful merchants in their place after they tried to overcharge us. Overall, I could rest at ease, knowing that the tablet buying process was in good hands. As for the temporary growth spheres, I was in no rush to use them just yet. My plan was simple. Activate 5 of them one after the next and use the maximum number of available tablets. The 6th temporary growth sphere I was planning to set aside for better days. I felt no temptation to be done with my null level for good. Why give up always receiving the maximum reward for every victory? I had lots left to do, and finishing it all would take a huge number of tablets and S's. At present, all silvers were going into leveling stats and spells for my new pets. By the end of the week, Cole and Sparky had hit level 40. They each got one new spell. Thunderstorm for Sparky and Fireway for Cole. The descriptions of the spells made an impression. I could only imagine what they would look like in person. The whip snakes themselves, then, had probably changed and grown visually as well. I was in no rush to summon them yet, though. First of all, there was no room for them, and second, I didn't see a good reason. We'd get acquainted at the end of the week. Me ended up getting something from the tablets and Ness's, too. We brought up his level to 20 and improved his stats and skills. The system told us that his Dome of Invisibility and Wave of Healing had hit their level cap at 6. Beyond that, me got another 2 new combat abilities, Sword Wielding and Archer. In connection with that, we ordered him some weapons and equipment from the Undermountain Craftsman. We didn't forget about the Gremlin's Potion Brewing either. He managed to get 2 recipes for level 1 in the skill. Now, in theory, me could brew 2 kinds of poison. I rubbed my hands together mentally. Now someone would be able to take on rebuilding the laboratory we found in Foreston next to the armory. I was planning to induct me as a magister as well. To do that, he would have to do some running around in the woods by the dark portal hunting for dark creatures. The Foxmaiden's sisters could take care of leveling him while I went underground to get the crystals. While I was traveling in Taria, many changes had taken place in Foreston. 20 new sequoias had put down roots inside the city. They were necessary to house a few foxfolk clans that came down from the north of the Dark Continent to join us. Merc's countrymen were fleeing yet another invasion. The necromancers' flying beasts had reached the icy passes. And with the arrival of the northern clans, the political situation in Foreston had changed sharply. The heads of the local houses had to work quickly to settle the issues. It didn't take long to deliberate, though. By the middle of the week, Foreston had been completely transformed into a monster hunter city. To avoid dishonoring the house heads, or the leaders of the newly arrived clans, I had to give them all the title of magister. And so, now, the order had a council of magisters. I was not afraid of placing power into the hands of the quarrelsome old foxmen. When they became monster hunters, they put themselves under my total authority. Basically, the council didn't make any decisions. The last word always laid with me. I simply gave the leaders, who were accustomed to holding power, a chance to voice their opinions on the issues of the day. Right now, our biggest problem is the war creeping ever closer to the city. The attacking necromancer spawn had transformed the forest around the city into one solid refugee tent camp, and it was no longer just halflings. Other denizens of the Dark Continent were now also coming, including ogres, trolls, elves, dryads, orcs, goblins. And though forest dwellers often moved on, called further by the heart of the forest, steppe dwellers generally stayed in the area around Foreston. They weren't all acting the same way either. Loners tried to blend in, and small clans and tribes tried to flex their muscle at first. But Merc didn't give them much chance to explain if they overstepped their bounds. They were told harshly whose land they were on and whose laws they had to obey. Don't like it? Go back to the steppe. Oh, don't want to? Then expect hard pushback. We realized the situation could spin out of control very soon. Now all the refugees were frightened and bled dry. But with time, when they came to their senses, it would turn into a free-for-all war. Our forest was gradually turning into a camp packed full of different races and tribes,
that had been at each other's throats right up until the flying monsters appeared. The halflings were the easiest to handle, especially after old friends showed up at Foreston's gates. Yes, the halflings Gorgie and I rescued from captivity by the Drax finally made it in the end. Elon, who had taken charge of the uprising in the snake den, and who was subsequently wounded by a poison tooth, had survived despite his uncommon injury. I was sincerely glad to see him. He, by the way, was equally happy to see me. After Elon and his brothers got seated at a table in my office and started greedily supping down the lunch provided, I learned that they had written me off for dead and their entire tribe had heard about my historic self-sacrifice. To say that Foreston struck them would be an understatement. Fox folk were always these semi-mythical creatures to them, but when they found out who called the shots around here, they were speechless. Then came their tale of woe. They had wandered the steppe looking for a suitable location for a new settlement for some time, but as soon as they found one, flying monsters appeared in the sky. After somehow repulsing the mystery beasts, the poor saps had to get back on the road. They had heard very recently that the legendary foxwork were offering sanctuary, and naturally, they did not believe it until they saw it with their own eyes. After our lunchtime chat, I ordered Elon's tribe to be allowed to enter Foreston and to be assigned one sequoia. By doing that, I both helped my friends and showed the other halflings still outside the city walls that friendship with me paid off. The response was immediate. By day two, there was a delegation at the gates consisting of a dozen elders from several halfling clans. We met the emissaries in the council hall where all magisters other than Brown were present. He was still in our castle on the other side of the dead ocean. After a brief introduction, without much ado, the heads of the halfling houses asked what would be required for them to live inside the city walls. We had a few terms, an oath of loyalty to the order and its supreme magister, that is, me, extensive contributions to the city both military and otherwise, and finally, strict adherence to our internal laws. Surprisingly, the halflings didn't put up their hackles. They accepted all the terms without even discussing. They must have been expecting approximately that. When the agreement had been sealed with an oath, a few of the elders even breathed sighs of relief. They were seemingly willing to accept even less favorable conditions. I wasn't going to abuse my position, which I had told all my magisters in advance. We needed friends and allies, not slaves. A paradox. That was exactly what the Steel King had once called me. I'm reminded that, at that time, I thought the ruler of Fraudy was not such a bad guy. If only I knew who the goddess Fortuna had really brought into my path. Beyond the halflings, it was quite simple to reach an arrangement with the trolls. First of all, there weren't many of them, just six families. And second, their mistrust and suspicion disappeared without a trace as soon as I showed them the amulet I got from the troll shaman. They didn't want to live in the city. And no wonder. A troll's home is in the forest. Like all forest dwellers, they were here because of the heart's call, but decided they wanted to take a look around before heading deeper into the woods. After I told them the true state of affairs in the newly rooted great forest, they lit up, packed up their belongings, and got underway to the other side of Narrow Lake the same day. Just in case they ran into problems with a keeper, I advised them to say that they were my friends. The orcs, goblins, and ogres had yet to reach out, but that was all just a matter of time. Before I left, I gave Merc clear instructions for what to do if the refugee situation spun out of control. Thankfully, the albino already knew what to do, so I left Foreston feeling at ease. I was slightly worried about me, even wanted to leave Gorgie with him, but Merc promised me he'd look after the gremlin. On top of that, I would need the Harn support myself, and there was no talk of me taking anyone else along. I was not planning on risking the lives of my friends. Based on Gallia's tales, the boundary of the Abyss was one of the most dangerous places in our world. "Ready?" I asked in a somewhat nervous voice. Gorgie responded and fell to the ground with his head tilting to the right. We were in the mountains not far from her castle. Not a soul around. A good place for a first encounter. There was no reason to keep this waiting any longer. Logically, I understood that these two snakes were also my pets just the same as Gorgie, and that they, as the line opposite their name said, were absolutely loyal to me. But the memories of the giant sphere they were born from and grew up to unbelievable size in were still dancing before my eyes.
Though I was afraid with my current figures, I couldn't even imagine how I'd be feeling without all that will. Not doubting myself another second, I activated the summoning amulets. And a few moments later, two huge snakes appeared 10 paces away from us in midair. When I saw how big they were, I gulped only to find my throat completely dry. They had only really gone up 10 levels, but they looked twice as big. Queen of the Drax, eat your heart out. Next to these giants, she would have seemed like a pale little grass snake. Like Gorgie after the first time I activated his summoning amulet, the snakes seemed somewhat disoriented. Turning their huge heads all around, they stared nervously into the distance while hissing menacingly. The sound made all my body hair stand on end. I thought I was the only one to get so spooked, but I glanced at Gorgie and realized it had gotten to him as well. Cole's black and gold body quickly heated up. The sheer amount of steam coming off the ground was staggering. A bit more and his scales would turn white hot. Sparky curled up into a tight little ball, looking like a glowing hedgehog. But instead of spines, her skin flickered with hundreds of forking bolts of lightning. Time to get started. Raising my right hand up while trying to make my voice sound steady, I said, "All right, kiddos, settle down. We're all friends here. See, it's just me and Gorgie. We're family. Nobody's gonna hurt you." After saying the last part, I chuckled to myself. To think, us hurting them. They'd have nothing to worry about from just about anyone. The whip snakes simultaneously turned their heads in my direction, making them look like two curious geese. As soon as the meaning of my words hit them, their bodies went back to how they looked before. That made me breathe a sigh of relief. Cole stopped melting the stone around him, while Sparky relaxed the tight coils of her body. A second later, they both came our way. My throat went dry again. Out of the corner of my eye, I glanced at Gorgie, but, much to my surprise, the Harn was not showing any signs of unease. In fact, it was more the opposite. He was deeply intrigued, and totally unbothered by the fact that he looked like a little kitten compared to the two monsters. Looking on with dignity as my new pets approached and formed a powerful ring with their bodies, I fearlessly placed my face beneath their big, huge, warm split tongues. Gorgie and I were carefully sniffed all over, and a few minutes later, we were rewarded with a loud hiss that just about made me go deaf. That was my little snakes expressing their happiness to meet me. Gorgie matched their pace. He jumped fearlessly onto Sparky's back and started sniffing her red scales. I meanwhile gave Cole a delicate pat on the black nose. Watching my three pets peacefully getting to know one another, I gradually settled down. I wonder how the others will react to my new little beasties. I didn't notice it right away, but there was a system notification floating before my eyes. "Attention! The higher powers have taken note of your accomplishment. You are the first person in many centuries to domesticate and summon three pets at the same time. Congratulations, you receive Experience Essence 700,000, Diamond Tablet 50, Iridescent Tablet, Cohesion with Pet 2. Really? After rereading the notification with surprise, I opened the description of the Iridescent. It said that, after using the tablet, my passive cohesion with pet magic ability would change. Essentially, it would gain another effect. And specifically, from now on, every victory by any of my pets would now be giving me rewards too, in full measure. As if I myself had just defeated the same opponent. That meant I no longer had to deal any damage to my pet's opponents. I would get a reward no matter what. While activating the tablet, I tossed 10 points into mind. Now that was up to 69. Rereading the new effect's description, I gave a satisfied smile. Good thing I decided to activate the growth spheres after my trip to the border of the abyss. The four of us will probably reap a rich harvest of tablets there.
"So you've made up your mind,"
Lu Moa said both inquisitively and affirmatively. I summoned the mother of the Stoneheart brood the day after I met my whipsnakes. The amulet she had given me worked its magic. Before the hour was up, the familiar hunchbacked figure was at the castle walls. Stepping out of the gates, I greeted the old blind woman and declared my intention to go find the body of the guardian of the Lord of the Deep.
"I see," she answered. "You need lots of crystals fast. Methinks you want to bring to life an army of golems."
"You know about it?"
"Who hasn't heard of the Bronze Legion?
The blind old woman snorted. I could hear pain and anger in her voice. In their time, the kobolds must have taken quite a bit of damage from the deadly gnomish machines.
And what if I don't want to help you bring that army to life?
The matriarch tilted her head to the side. You do remember the oath, right? I asked.
Umar forgets nothing,
the old woman barked back. The prospect of bringing the golems back to life must not have filled her with joy. By breaking a blood oath, you will be inviting ruin into the lives of yourself and your children, I reminded her.
I said what I said,
the matriarch hissed through her teeth.
I forget nothing.
Then what's the point of this conversation? I shrugged my shoulders. The old woman breathed a loud sigh and lowered her shoulders fatefully.
You can't even imagine how much trouble those machines have caused us.
As far as I know, the kobolds did their fair share of damage too, I said. I had taken some time to study the two races' ancient conflict.
You're probably right,
the matriarch said thoughtfully. For my part, I can assure you that while you are on order of monster hunter territory, you will not be under threat. I had to somewhat soften the tone of the conversation. Without the Legion, we will not be able to defeat our foes, I added. We're up against the whole world. As a matter of fact, if not for darkness and the necromancers, I would not be taking part in the conflict. But in the labyrinth of fright, I saw what those bastards are capable of. The old woman was listening carefully, as if combing my words for deceit. After a bit of silence, she said mutedly,
All right. A deal's a deal. Are you going alone or taking a group? Actually, you don't have to answer. With beasties like that, you don't need a group. Yes, yes, don't act surprised. It would be hard not to smell your little steaks. Are you ready?
Yes, I responded firmly, then turned and waved goodbye to Brown, who was standing up on the wall and watching us closely.
Then follow me,
the old woman said and made a barely perceptible hand motion. At that very moment, a portal arch appeared before us. Chapter 3. After following the old woman through the portal arch, I found myself in a huge underground room. I looked around in a daze. Oh, gods! Did someone really have to go through all the trouble of building this? Gigantic carved columns, their tops reaching somewhere up beneath the stone ceiling of the cave, struck me with their monumentality. Upon closer inspection, I realized it was not a room at all. In fact, it was a never-ending corridor with stone columns lining its walls like trees.
Well, how'd you like it?
The old woman chuckled.
Make an impression?
Yep, I didn't lie.
The ancient palace of 10,000 columns,
the matriarch said with esteem in her voice.
It was built by the primordials. Now it serves as a nursery for unclean beasts of every stripe.
After she said that, she spat on the ground in disgust. I don't get it, I responded with surprise. I thought we were going to the border of the abyss.
Go down 3 floors and you'll find your border,
she answered cantankerously. I just don't get it, I shook my head. Is the border here in the palace?
That's right,
the old woman nodded.
Right where an ancient fool once opened the original dark portal. No one remembers his name any longer, but everyone in our world knows of the abyss.
One second. Did you say this place is full of dark beasts?
Yes,
she nodded.
The descendants of those who managed to make it across the boundary and be reborn before the Keeper of the Deep sealed the portal. Then he left a few guardians behind, but our people got mired in war and forgot about the defenders. And meanwhile, the Keeper ordered us to take care of the ancient golems. But then, with time, they stopped working.
And the beasts multiplied, I finished her thought. There's just one thing I can't figure. Why are all these monsters still here? Why haven't they come up to the surface?
There have many reasons,
the old lady answered readily.
Turn around. See that stone arch? That is how you leave the palace. It is imbued with powerful sorcery. It doesn't stop me, as you see, though it does sap an incredible amount of energy. The beasts, though, can't get through.
I nodded understandingly. Stone Town is guarded by similar magic.
Beyond that, the matriarch continued, we are very deep beneath the earth. The local creatures don't particularly enjoy coming up to the surface. They have no reason. There's plenty of grub down here for them.
And where exactly are the remains of the stone snake? I asked.
The last time I saw them, they were right on the border of the abyss. In other words, you'll have to go down 3 floors. The palace itself is a huge spiral, a path of sorts, leading straight into the heart of the deep. But you don't need to go there. Just go down 3 levels.
What do you mean I don't have to? I squinted.
Who else?
The woman snorted.
I ain't going. Even in my best years, there was nothing for me down there. My legs barely carried me out last time, and those days are long gone. I'm too old for that kind of monkey business.
And your portal can't take me? I asked with hope in my voice.
Nope,
she threw out shortly with no explanation.
You'll have to scamper down on your own, too. If you make it out alive, come right back here and activate the amulet. That's all. I've upheld my end of the bargain. Could I maybe convince you to turn around before it's too late?
I took a look around. Tempting, but no. I need those crystals. With all due respect, no, I responded. I didn't come all the way down here just to turn tail and run.
Well, you know best,
the old woman shrugged.
My job is to make suggestions and warnings.
After that, she opened the portal and stepped through. And an instant later, I was all alone. All right, time to let out my trusty beasties. When the first creature came near, Sparky told me. With a menacing hiss, waves of magic lightning ran down her body. And another few seconds after that, I myself sensed the approaching darkness. My mouth filled with viscous, bitter saliva. The six-legged monster looked most of all like a sea crab. The only difference was its size. The freak racing our way was as big as a wagon. Encased in a thick shell of chitin armor, its appendages clacked loudly on the stone floor. Its massive pincers gave the odd gnash, violating the centenary silence of the halls. I was about to activate Avatar, but Cole beat me to the punch. When the giant crab was about 20 paces from us, the black whip snake curled up, suddenly spat out a fireball the size of a watermelon, and it flew towards the brute as fast as a stone from a catapult. An instant later, the fireball, ignoring all obstacles, burned through the monster's chitin armor and exploded into its body. I stood there stunned, my mouth agape. What just happened? Before my eyes came a system notification. Your pet has killed Serrated Hexapod, level 50. Congratulations, you receive Experience Essence 10,000, Gold Tablet 2, Silver Tablet 20, Monster Hunter Token 100, Large Orb of Darkness 10. I rubbed my hands together, smiling with satisfaction. If things kept up like this, the walk down to the border with the abyss would be little more than a jaunt through a city park. As soon as I thought that, I heard a crunching sound from the depths of the tunnel. At first, I couldn't figure out what it was, but the closer the sound came, the more it hit me. The crab's death had not gone unnoticed. Its family had come to pay us a visit. And based on the nasty scraping and cracking sounds, it had a big family. A very big family. I made certain of that a few minutes later, when a literal wave of the slain crab's family members came crashing down on us. Before I managed to do anything, Cole distinguished himself again. What reaction times these snakes have? With a menacing hiss, the whip snake shook his thick tail like an oversized whip, and another wave, this one of fire, rolled out to meet the wave of creatures. The heat that smacked me in the face right after made me put up an elbow. I could hear the hair crackling on my head. I moved my elbow away just as the two waves collided. The heat of the firewall was so scorching that the first few rows of creatures running our way went up like torches even before it hit them. I looked on spellbound as the huge 15-foot wall of fire swallowed up the six-legged monsters, unable to believe my eyes. What horror had I unleashed upon this world? Before my eyes ran a solid wall of victory messages and loot drops. Meanwhile, the wall of fire kept going for a whole 20 yards. It was enough to take down the majority of the crab onslaught. But the whip snakes didn't just sit around waiting for the conclusion. They dashed forward with loud hissing. And just 2 minutes later, the system reported back to me that I had defeated a herd of serrated hexapods. The numbers were dazzling. All told, 240 of them had been killed. That brought me about 3 million S's, 500 gold tablets, no less than 5,000 silvers, 25,000 tokens, and 2,500 orbs of darkness. Beyond that, the queen of the herd died in the tsunami of fire, and she was level 80. For her, the system awarded me 10 diamond tablets and 50 silvers. But most importantly, the higher powers had a high appreciation of our contribution toward exterminating dark beasts and generously awarded me another iridescent containing a legendary spell by the name of Fracture. Fracture. Level 0 plus 5. 0 of 30. Type, spell. Rarity, legendary. Description. After activation, partially removes opponent's defenses. Effect. Reduces opponent defense by 70%. Maximum number of enemies, 100. Requirements. Intellect, 80. Expends 10,000 mana points. Note. Cooldown time, 2 hours.
Well, kiddos, I said with a heavy sigh, here we are, level 3. By my estimation, it had been around 5 days since the blind old woman brought me to this cursed palace. All that time, we had been suffering attacks from the local brutes, and there really were a lot of them. They'd multiplied and eaten a lot over the years. To be frank, if not for the snakes, Gorgie and I would have died in the first few minutes of the crab swarm. Anyone who doesn't just so happen to have two unique pets should only come to these caverns backed by an army numbering in the thousands. In that time, by our joint efforts, we had taken down around 900 monsters. My pockets were practically bursting with tablets and S's. That's not counting the few hundred valuable pieces of loot I got, such as fangs, armor shells, claws, and other body parts of epic and legendary quality. We were practically walking on money, and I was not planning on leaving a single cent behind. I just had to think of a foolproof method of bringing all these riches up to the surface. I already had some ideas. Beyond that, the higher powers had generously given me another 2 iridescent tablets. The first contained a mass legendary spell by the name Curse of Weakness, which cut opponents' damage by 50%, and it stayed active for 2 hours. The second contained a spell called Strength Replenishment, which would restore 40% energy for myself and allies. The 30 points I got from the 3 iridescents I invested into Will. All told, I was up to 458 points. On the one hand, that was a huge amount, but on the other, it was all thanks to the founder set gear. Who could guarantee the Steel King or his allies wouldn't have similar artifacts? And so, no matter how badly I wanted to invest in other characteristics, if someone took control of me using mental magic, that would be curtains for us. To be frank, I was hoping for a larger number of iridescent tablets. Clearly, my deeds were no longer impressive enough to attract the attention of the higher powers. The stakes are constantly rising, but I wasn't worried. In fact, I was happy. Unlike the 2 previous levels, it was surprisingly quiet at the border of the abyss. As we walked forward, not a single monster came out to greet us. But that didn't mean there weren't any. More the opposite. All that time, my pets were saying they could sense something very dark and very dangerous somewhere up ahead. At first, I thought they were reacting to the ancient portal, but the closer we came, the more unmistakable the threat became. We found the golem's body a few hours after reaching the 3rd floor. When I saw the big, huge pile of rocks blocking the corridor, at first I thought a column had collapsed. But when we got up close, I realized it was no column. It was a giant stone snake, or rather, what was left of it. It had clearly been butchered by someone who knew what they were doing. At first, I was even afraid the mysterious marauders hadn't left even a tiny shard behind. But when I got up even closer, I was quickly reassured. Its ripped open belly contained enough crystals for several bronze legions. I even wanted to go inside the wonder machine to get a better look at the riches we'd stumbled upon. But Gorgie gave a warning roar and the 2 snakes hissed, forcing me to turn around. Whatever my pets had been sensing all that time was coming to pay us a visit. At first, the mysterious monster looked like a huge ball of darkness. I even thought we were dealing with a spirit like the kind I grappled with after defeating the Black Blood Patriarch.
But as the dark ball came closer, I realized that the boss of these caverns was made of flesh and blood. When the darkness dispersed, before us stood a fiend in some way reminiscent of a huge monitor lizard, but standing up on its hind legs. Level 110. A wide maw, two rows of sharp teeth, thick scales, powerful arms, long claws. A serious enemy. On top of all that, it also could perform magic. The toxic green flame emanating from its jaws was clear proof of that. At the beginning, I was slightly overwhelmed by the sheer power wafting off the monster. I was especially put off by its high level. But level isn't all that important. Its characteristics and skills are what matter, especially their level. Now, my pets were most likely as good as they could be for their levels. Quickly activating Avatar of Chaos, I raised my right hand high and growled out loudly. I was quickly backed up by all my beasties, and then all four of us raced on the attack at once. After landing a combined blow, the great system said we had entered combat with a lesser demon of the abyss. And again, I thank the heavens for my new pets. The demon simply didn't stand a chance against us. Streams of fire mixed with lightning and chaos arrows rained down on the creature of the abyss. The demon tried to tuck and roll and use its hands and feet to block, but nothing was working. My newly acquired fracture sapped practically all its defenses. I saw the monster's scales falling off in sheets. Just another few minutes of fighting and the demon looked like a singed chicken. Then its right arm broke off and fell to the floor. That was from Gorgie cutting its tendons with his tail. The harness racing around the giant as it roared in bitter fury, stinging it like a wasp. The demon tried clumsily to stand back up, but the snakes wrapping around its limbs didn't allow it to do that. Cole turned white hot while Sparky used lightning magic. The smell of burning flesh made me gasp. Finally, the brute gave a few twitches and fell limp. The lesser demon of the abyss didn't even manage to get off a single move against us. You have killed Lesser Demon of the Abyss, level 110. Congratulations, you receive Experience Essence 22,000, Diamond Tablet 5, Gold Tablet 20, Silver Tablet 50, Monster Hunter Token 500, Large Orb of Darkness 20. Attention, Grand Magister, the higher powers smile upon you. You have replicated the fourth achievement of the founder of the Order of Monster Hunters, Gunnar the Destroyer. You are the first person in 500 years to slay a demon of the abyss. Congratulations, you receive Monster Hunter Token 100,000. Ring of Gunnar the Destroyer, 1. Fibula of Gunnar the Destroyer, 1. Iridescent Tablet, Demon of the Abyss.
Is that what I think it is?
The old lady nodded with a dazed look at the big, huge body of the golem. After defeating the demon, I spent some time considering how to transport the stone snake to the exit. The problem was that it contained an unexpectedly high amount of crystal. A few of them were as big as Gorgie. Such huge stones would be great for creating supplies for castles or forts. Reading my thoughts, Cole once again took the initiative. He grabbed the golem's tail in his teeth and with practically no strain started hauling. When he got tired, Sparky took over, and Gorgie and I didn't have to do a thing other than walk unencumbered next to them. All told, it took us just over a day to get back. We had already slain all the most dangerous monsters, and the little ones weren't in any great rush to attack. So, we made it to the exit quickly. Yes, I nodded. This is the guardian you told me about. I wonder how kobolds see the world. The fact the old woman had no eyes didn't mean a thing. She could get by just fine without them.
Okay, what next?
She asked with derision.
What do you mean?
Feigning surprise, I answered her question with a question.
We need to bring this guy up to the surface. And not just him, by the way. All three levels here are just littered with our loot. I do not intend to leave so many goodies behind.
The old woman chuckled.
Curious. So how are you planning on bringing it all up?
With your help, I shrugged.
The matriarch gave a raspy laugh.
That wasn't part of the deal. Or did you forget?
I chuckled. That put my mind at ease. The old woman must know 100% how to bring this thing up. Otherwise, she'd have said right away that she didn't. All right, Let's make another deal then, I shrugged again. What's stopping us?
I'm interested,
she said with her head tilted to the side.
What do you have to offer me for the help? Let me be up front. I have no use for crystals or body parts from the creatures you have slain.
A new home, I responded and watched the Matrix face pout quizzically. She was seemingly not expecting that. Somewhere far from the gnomes, with no enemies, where my order will always come to the aid of you and your children.
Go on,
the old woman said mutedly with hope in her voice.
What do you know about a place called the Crooked Mountains?
Chapter 4
Never heard of them, the old woman responded tensely.
Where are they?
Far, I answered. On another part of the continent, in a land known as Taria.
The matriarch nodded to tell me she had heard of it.
Gnomes?
She asked shortly. Not a single one in a 1,000-mile radius, I answered with a smile.
Monsters?
Just weaklings. The highest level one I saw was 30.
Darkness?
The old woman asked with suspicion. There used to be a dark portal, but I destroyed it completely a year ago.
And this land belongs to you?
It belongs to the Order, which makes it mine. There is an ancient abandoned city down there built by the gnomes for the hunters. Stone Town. After a brief pause, the matriarch said,
I don't understand.
What don't you understand? I asked.
You are willing to allow my family into your home just in exchange for help delivering the loot to the surface,
she said dubiously.
What's the catch?
That cheered me up even more. The old woman was so caught off guard she said too much. Apparently bringing up everything we collected here today to the surface wouldn't be particularly challenging for her. I'm not going to lie, I nodded. I have a few ideas of how to bring life to those lands. Believe me, you and your children would have nothing to fear. And to top it all off, I will always come to your aid.
And what do you want in return?
Copper could once be found there, but in the last few years the vein has run dry. The old woman smiled.
You want us to look for new veins?
Well, why not? I asked. What's wrong with that? We'll live side by side, like good neighbors, helping each other out.
The gnomes once said the same thing,
she snorted. So you made a bum deal, I shrugged.
Go back to living on someone else's lands,
the old woman whispered regretfully. At first, yes, I answered. But in a few years, you'll be given land to call your own. The matrix head gave a sharp twitch.
You would do that for us?
With ease, I answered. There's plenty of room there. Enough for everyone. Plus, people don't like living underground. We are not gnomes. We need fresh air, sun, and a sky over our heads. But we also need minerals. Despite the fact the copper vein dried up, I bet there's lots of stuff worth taking down there.
Oh,
the matriarch chuckled.
Don't you doubt it. The deep conceals many riches.
I smiled. So, you see, we can be of use to one another. Even though the Order and your people were once hostile, now we can turn over a new leaf. The old woman didn't think long. With a heavy sigh, as if gathering the courage to dive into a dark hole, she raised her head and asked,
Blood oath?
Blood oath, I confirmed and extended my hand to shake hers.
Everything is almost ready,
Wheeze said wearily. The stocky orange foxman was a newcomer, but had proven himself very dependable over the last few weeks. I expected nothing less from someone recommended by Merc. The albino has a sixth sense for blight. Wheeze and a squad of 5 dozen troops with high loot figures had already been gathering and sorting through the loot from the monsters we'd slain for 3 days. After the kobold matriarch and I made our agreement, I took her portal up to the surface and traveled to Foreston to get a loot brigade together. I also took me and the fox maidens along so they could see the ancient palace and hunt the local monsters a bit. Merc quickly grasped the situation, put together a party of fox folk with the proper skills, and introduced me to Wheeze, who was supposed to take on the commander role. For the first while, the troops who had never left Foreston before felt ill at ease. It was their first time warping to another continent. Then they met the kobold matriarch. After that came another warp, this time to an ancient palace somewhere in the heart of the deep. They reacted as expected to my snakes. Shock, panic, fear, nape first standing on end. If not for the fox manes, one might have thought the Grand Magister, that is, me, had some terrifying plan in mind. But after gradually realizing that no one was planning to eat or sacrifice them to subterranean monsters, the troops got themselves.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.